Gnosis means knowledge of the most esoteric kind. This is the story that has been kept from the ears of mankind for too long. It is a truth hidden beneath the layers of religious deceit for centuries. This is the truth behind the world's most infamous secret societies, including the Knights Templar. It is the revelation of the Archaeon secrets of mankind and the amazing discovery of the secret of Solomon's Temple, and you cannot live life until you have Gnosis. Many people have no understanding of what Gnosis means other than it simply means knowledge and leave it at that, yet there is a deeper meaning attached to this word. It is a word that gave rise to the term Gnostic, or one who has this special knowledge. They practiced a spirituality that was distinctly more Eastern than the Western version of Christianity we see around us today. The term Gnosis in truth is the direct mystical experience of the divine in the self. It is the realization of the true nature of ourselves, and cannot be discerned by intellectual dogma and doctrine. For whoever that does not know self does not know anything, but whoever knows self already has acquired knowledge about the depth of the universe. So were the words of Christ according to St. Thomas, and these few words reveal the depth of the belief in this peculiar and seemingly difficult to comprehend system. It seems we are being told by the ancients that the most important place to search for truth, the divine, and for ultimate knowledge of the universe is within ourselves. The goal of this Gnosis is to discover this true inner reality, which also gives us an insight into the very universe. I shall give you what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no hand has touched, and what has never arisen in the human mind. These were the words attributed to Christ, and what we shall discover is that this Christ of the Gospels is nothing other than the true inner reality of ourselves. The words of Christ match those of other leading historical avatars because it is a type of archetype within each one of us in a very quantum way. If we can attain this knowledge and wisdom of this true Christ, then we shall be able to see what no eye has seen, and hear what no ear has heard. We shall truly touch what has never arisen in the human mind, because what we shall see is much more than just the creation of this human mind of ours. Because of mankind's attempts at manifesting the mystical into the physical world, he has created mysteries for the rest of us. The secret knowledge presented here would only have resulted in my own tormented death at the fiery stake had I written so blatantly in previous centuries. Only those who already knew the secrets has the eyes to see and the ears to hear. Men who we would today class as alchemists and occultists hid their understanding behind language and imagery that was multi-layered. In order for us to fully comprehend exactly what this Gnosis is, we must first understand the background and history to this hidden world. We must come to an understanding that our present orthodox history is basically incorrect. Why so, I hear you ask? Quite simply, over the course of the last few centuries, there has been an ongoing rewriting of history by those in power, both ecclesiastical and political. As any good historian will tell you, the history of the world has been written mainly by the victors. The victory could be a military conquest, a political or religious campaign. Either way, the losers are generally silenced and eradicated from the history books, or even vilified and made to look foolish. When we are told that the war was won by the glorious and good, we must be wary of what we read. The same is true when we read of the supposed victories of, say, Christianity. We read, for instance, that St. Patrick went to Ireland and defeated the serpents, eradicating the country of all the indigenous snakes. This is blatantly not true, as Ireland has no snakes. In fact, what this little story is really referring to is the existence of a serpent-worshipping cult in Ireland from prehistoric times that were replaced by the new cult of Christianity, and this is linked to the worship of what we will discover to be the wisdom of the serpent. It also refers to the fact that Saint Patrick overcame the power of the serpent and therefore mastered it. The snake is intricately linked with magic and mythology in almost every culture. and it is seen as the personification of wisdom and goodness and alternatively the personification of evil. This revealing the duality it implicits to its nature and the nature of the energy serpents known as the Ida and Pingala, which reverse the spine in the Hindu tradition known as the Kundalini. This Kundalini explain one of the reasons why the serpent or snake was used in all wisdom literature, as the Kundalini was the expression of the path to true wisdom. Its dual nature of both the cure and the killer is almost unique. This internal union has been depicted throughout history as the sexual union, and eventually came through in history as the alchemist's hermaphrodite or androgyny figure. Some say that the snake was originally the symbol of the virgin goddess giving birth to the cosmos unaided by any male principle. An almost androgynous element of creation, the coiled or spirally symbol of the serpent representing her vagina. In Egyptian mythology, the pyramids texts speak of the snake as celestial, earthly and subterranean. A trinity aspect, as the divine phallus, the serpent was perpetual copulation with Mother Earth and represented the axis mundi passing through all three realms of hell, earth and heaven. All of this is symbolic of opening up a pathway in ourselves to allow an internal dialogue between our lower nature and our higher senses or consciousness. Now we must turn to the enlightenment experience. This experience, we must understand, comes from the internal, chemical, electrical and biological reactions to our own thought processes. It is in essence something we can create ourselves, and this is the divinity within ourselves spoken of, albeit in hidden language, by many ancient and not so ancient writers. The early messiahs were gurus and shaman who understood how the world worked in their own unique way. They received their knowledge via the trance state and this inner enlightenment experience. This energy is nothing more than the serpent fire, solar force or pyranic energy of the serpent worshipping mystics of the world. Without the energy of the serpent fire, there could be no Gnosis, or so we are told. It is also very easy to say that we will have this energy, but we must also control it. And what is this energy? And have scientists ever discovered it or even looked for it? Over the course of human history, there have been thousands of individuals who have claimed to have experienced enlightenment or illumination, giving rise to the term shining as far back in history as we care to go. If it is true that mankind across the world and across time have been having these experiences, and they are very real experiences, then it is true to state that they must be brought on by some kind of energy. This energy is both the electrical charge within the nervous system to the brain and the chemical and biological reactions within our brain brought on by numerous methods of meditation, prayer and dervish. These ancient methods were discovered over the course of tens of thousands of years and have been perfected by initiates in the depths of many cults and creeds. The methods do work. They do create alternate states of awareness via the electrical, chemical and biological reactions that they generate. The question scientists, among them psychologists, are asking is simply whether the reactions are purely biological functions accidentally discovered by mankind, or are they truly mystical and spiritual capacities of the higher self? The answer to this can in the end only lay with the individual, but we may have other insights into the whole scientific element of the process by digging a little deeper. In ancient Sanskrit, there is a word known as sunya, and simply put, it means zero and is related to a modern concept known as the void. How is this ancient metaphysical concept of nothingness related to a modern quantum world we call the void? And how is this related to the ultimate knowledge of mankind? Imagine, if you will, a large sea or lake. We know in our Western world that this body of water is made up of tiny molecules which themselves are made up of atoms. Inside these amazing atoms, we discover a mini solar system not dissimilar to the solar systems we see ourselves. This mini solar system is made of a nucleus which is equated with the sun, with electrons revolving around it like planets. The space between these mini-stars and planets is the science of the void and is no different to the void of the space between the Sun and its orbiting planets. In actual fact, the majority of both the mini-solar system in the atom and that of the macrocosmic solar system is made up of this void. Incredibly, if we were to travel even further into the center of the nucleus, we would find exactly the same thing again. Well, what does this show? So far and for the relationship to the ancient teachings, it reveals to us the truth behind the concepts of as above, so below, from the infamous Semitic emerald tablet attributed to Hermes and well known in the occult of our chemical world. This void, or zero-point energy, is in fact the substance of thought. It is the quantum realm of our real consciousness through the entanglement of particles known today as quantum entanglement. These thought can, indeed through modern science, be entangling with other particles, and hence what we have is what the alchemists called the universal mind, or in popular terms, God. The world of the mystic and the enlightenment process is nothing more than the accessing of this universal mind via the ability to be conscious of the point of quantum entanglement, to be aware of the unconscious world and the numerous connections between our mind at the subatomic level and the subatomic universe. The world of the mystic and the enlightenment process is nothing more than the accessing of this universal mind via the ability to be conscious at the point of quantum entanglement, to be aware of the unconscious world and the numerous connections between our mind at the subatomic level and the subatomic universe. The methods employed by the adept were a heightened state of awareness of this quantum world internally, and due to the very nature of the process, the mystic comes back with vision that are on the one hand archetypal and on the other unusual. It is archetypal because it has seen the same the world over. It is unusual in the fact that the ordinary mind cannot comprehend what the non-ordinary mind has seen. What the mystic, the Hindu, Muslim Sufi, Christian Gnostic or alchemist is revealing is the human interpretation of a very real scientifically theoretical quantum world of the unconscious. This experience is what they termed the real self, the experience of our own self-consciousness remained a universal constant, just as the ancients believed Christ is all, in all. The truth is that the Shay man who led the process finding ways to were finding ways to higher consciousness to be closer to their gods. This knowledge is passed on to the tribe where required through visual arts and practical healing techniques. All the things man has seen through this process are therefore nothing but an illusion created only within the brain. But this theory neglects the quantum side of existence, that all things are connected, that all is one, and that everything depends upon everything else. So too does our mind depend upon the universal mind. There can be no doubt that drugs can bring on a process known to the mystics as the enlightenment. There can equally be no doubt that these processes can also be brought on by physical and mental actions, creating neuron transmissions that affect our thoughts and release chemical hormones. But all of this is simply reducing the process down to a scientifically physical, chemical and biology action. The question is not how the experience is brought on. The question is what truth is there to it. Is this process a truth of human evolution, and is this process being caused by the union of ourselves with the collective superconscious state or the universal mind? Are we in fact creating our own evolution in a quantum universe? What evidence does show is that subjects do experience a great light or shining, just as the ancients have stated on numerous occasions, and we now know to be part of the true enlightenment experience. The experience cannot be a result of man searching for eternal life, as each culture would bring about different results. This is then a result of human evolution, whether the simple biological, genetic and universal process of evolution or via co-evolved nature with the very existence of another quantum dimension. This would explain the serpent image, which has been seen as both the double helix of DNA and as energy waves. Either way, the wavy line physically manifested on this level of existence as the snake is a universal image underlying the very basic levels of existence itself. We have seen how the kundalini energy of Hindu prana and the scientist's zero-point energy has also been described as serpent fire by others. The brazen serpent of Moses is portrayed as a flaming serpent, and Jesus is equated to this serpent. The brazen serpent of Moses is nothing more than the power of the healing kundalini seen in the Hindu tradition. So what we have here is a belief in healing serpent energy rising up a pole or spine that spans the period between the Old Testament and the New, but more than that, that this serpent healer was there right at the start too in Genesis. And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die." Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die, for God knows that in the day you eat of it your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So eating the fruits of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, which could only be the tree of knowledge of good and evil or the tree of life, will make you like God, that is, it will aid you to realize your own true potential, to realize the God within, the internal divinity. This is simply because you'll be eating something that is inside yourself. The world denies us this element of ourself. Our own desires and greedy nature denies us ourself. The ancients tell us in all good faith to eradicate those desires, deny the world its power over us, and to truly find out what lays within. We've either been misled or forgot. And how to read the truth? Early Gnostic texts regarded Eve as the serpent herself, guarding the secrets of divine immortality and wisdom. They taught that the Hebrews had regarded Eve with jealousy, and stole the creation of mankind from the serpent and attributed it to Yahweh. How right they were, and yet they were called heretics for their statements. At other points in tradition, the Eve myth takes on masculine edge when she is married to Ophion, Helios, or the Agatha demon, all great serpent deities, and all showing clearly that the fables of Genesis are based upon a serpent cult and the union of the serpentine energies we know as the kundalini in Hindu tradition. The dual nature of man must reunite in order to be one again with the deity. Eve, of course, must unite with Adam. In the old Akkad tongue, Ad signifies the father and a mythical person with whom Adam is most allied, such as Seth or Saturn or Thoth, and others were serpent deities. Adam and Eve are therefore both symbolic serpents of energy within man that must unite in order to bring about the true Son of Man, which is the Christ. Christianity, or more to the point, Gnostic Christianity, early on developed this ancient system until the concept of the Holy Trinity was finally written down. This is the Father, which is the male principle, the Mother, the female principle, and the Son of Man, which the ultimate result of a perfect union. This is why Jesus is God and also the Son of God, because he is the result of the reuniting of the elements on division of the one God. The Bible is a repeating pattern of initiation into the mysteries of the human mind. It is a tool to teach us about ourselves and is, according to most scholarly sources, an accumulation of other wisdom and religious literature from Mesopotamia, Egypt, Persia, and elsewhere. It is the sum of these other sources that we must now turn to see if the same repeating pattern of psychological and philosophical teaching is to be found. Similar beliefs are shared with the sacred Jewish Torah, the priestly code to be found in the Pentateuch and said to have been given to Moses by God. This written Torah is said to have been passed through the oral Torah first, emerging from darkness. Kabbalists of the 13th century wrote down their understanding of this inner divine in a book we know as the Zohar, the word meaning radiance, and this is due to the divine light which is the Torah reflected in the mysteries of the Zohar. The literal meaning people see in the Zohar is darkness. Only by seeing the hidden, mystical interpretation will we make a new reading of the Zohar more exciting and revelatory. The tree seen in the Zohar is said to produce fruit through the water that God provides. God's water is called Hakmar and means wisdom. It is Sophia, or wisdom that will enable the tree to bear fruit, which is the soul of a righteous man. Shekinah will only dwell with the righteous and only through Hieros Gamos, or holy union of the male and female principles, is this possible. The ancient goddess Sophia, who gave her name to the great mosque of Istanbul, is this aspect of wisdom. The female principle is seen on many levels as that of wisdom, and it is symbolized often with water. This the reason that Mary is often seen on a boat or as a boat, she being the mistress of wisdom and her name meaning water. The boat, as in the symbol of the city of Paris, is also seen with an upright pole balanced upon the crescent moon-shaped boat. This is the moon aspect of the goddess, the negative or feminine principle. The pole is originally the tree of Asherah, as we shall see, and who is truly a modern version of our ancient Sophia. It is also the male principle and reveals the divine union. The title of Asherah in Phoenicia in North Africa is Tanith, meaning serpent lady. She is also known as the Lady of the Serpent. Also in the first millennium BC she was called Chowat, which is basically Chawa in Hebrew and Eve in English. Eve is therefore a remaking of Asherah, the Queen of Heaven and Serpent Lady. We should know that Eve came from Adam, and therefore Adam is El, the consort of Asherah. Asherah is the serpentine and feminine aspect of one of the original versions of the Hindu Kundalini. She appears 40 times in the Hebrew Bible and in 9 books. Asherim, which also appears in the Bible, are actually manufactured wooden poles made to mimic the Asherah trees, although in this name it is now a masculine ending. One of her symbols is actually 2 entwined serpents on the Asherah pole or tree of life. Asherah quite simply is the female energy on the tree of life, the goddess of life bearing fruit in the arid desert, sustaining. The goddess in the temple in our minds and our body is therefore the element of united wisdom within us. This concept was part and parcel of the Temple of Solomon. It was within the very precinct of that holy place that the religious authorities tried to wipe it out again and again. The Temple of Jerusalem has been built, destroyed, and wait for it, the Jewish and Christian faiths, not to mention the Freemasons, wanting building again. Why is this temple so important? And why is it like the nation of Israel, knocked down and rebuilt so many times throughout the Bible? There are, though, many hundreds of theories about the temple, and we should just consider a few of them. Probably the most interesting in the current climate is the concept that those medieval warrior monks, the Knights Templar, actually dug beneath the temple and discovered some great and tremendous secret. This secret is claimed to be the Ark of the Covenant, the Holy Grail, some incredible and deadly secret texts, or even the head of Christ. As most of the world seems to have gone mad on the Knights Templar, and as they seem to be intricately involved in the story of the temple itself, then we better spend a few moments considering their role in the history of it. This in itself may lead us into the real secret of the temple. In the 10th century BC, King Solomon the Wise supposedly founded the Temple of Jerusalem, or Solomon's Temple. This was not, as is widely perceived, a Jewish temple. Instead, it was a large church to pagan idols. Solomon, according to tradition, had hundreds of wives and hundreds of concubines, all of which came from across the Middle East and all of which worshipped different gods. All these gods were represented in this great center of Middle Eastern religion. There is, though, absolutely no evidence from other surrounding nations that any of this happened. However, the story goes that by 587, BC, the armies of Babylon had managed to destroy the temple, leaving the task of rebuilding to those Jews who were in Babylonian captivity. We would, of course, do well to remember that Babylon was often used as an allegory for sin, and therefore sin bought down the temple, and those who escaped sin would one day raise it up again. The temple is intricately linked with the now infamous Knights Templar. Indeed, it is the reason for their name, and the question has always been why. What was it that the Templars saw in the Temple of Jerusalem that so inspired them? In the preceding years following the return of certain Templars from the Middle East, we have an upsurge in what is known today as Gothic architecture. Before this period, churches were mainly small and often of wood. Suddenly, with the inspiration gathered from the Middle East, the various monastic orders, and generally led by the Templars linked Cistercians, Europe was awash with building fever, with over 80 cathedrals being built between 1128 and 1228 in France alone. All of these buildings had or have a Gnostic and mystical influence, with hidden symbolism rife within their stonework and giving rise to the great Freemasons. It is an accepted fact that the Templars were instigators in the rise of these Masons, and it is the Masons who hid the profound wisdom in the stones. Another amazing coincidence is that suddenly at this time Europe sees a rise in our chemical, astronomical, medical and philosophical texts, all of this running parallel to each other. The temple then was not made for one god but for numerous gods, and anyone who wished to worship their own god was in the right place regardless. This was a place of union, a joining of the opposites seen in the Kundalini experience, where the male and female, positive and negative, are joined to bring about true illumination. It was this mystical experience that was at the heart of the Templar attempted revival. This is what the hidden symbolism of the European churches and cathedrals speaks of. So now we understand the enlightenment or illumination of the mind. This very understanding was then taken further and brought to Europe, where it was physically manifested in the great cathedrals and churches, and all of this from the findings of the Crusaders in the Middle East. This newfound knowledge may very well have come from some of the discoveries made by the Templars, especially when we consider that the man responsible for energizing the building program was none other than Saint Bernard. This is the same Bernard who gave the Order of the Knights Templar their rules, and who was related by blood to various members. In all likelihood, the new building influence came about through the fresh and invigorating contact with Islamic and Middle Eastern architecture and the Islamic mathematical advances which had passed Europe by for centuries. The Muslims had two sides, esoteric and the exoteric, and the building of Europe were now somehow matching this hidden path. The Templars now grew in wealth and power, supposedly using their newfound wisdom, their landholding and banking systems making them one of the most powerful and feared groups in Europe. Virtually nobody could match their international strength. At their trials, the Templars were not only accused of worshipping the sacred head known today as Baphomet, but also the veneration of the serpent. I was wondering, though, whether the Templars had gained insight into the ancient wisdom we have been discussing, and whether they had included some more of the symbolism of that wisdom within their own, such as the serpent, and also whether this had grown so large and popular that it was just too dangerous for the Catholic authorities to accept. It would of course been an absolute heresy to claim that Jesus was a symbol of the divinity within, and that certain key Catholic doctrines were spuriously literal in the extreme. A symbol seen in various forms from Samaria to France is the Abraxas, a figure with snakes for legs, a symbol used for gods such as Oannes, and not surprisingly this later became the symbol of the Grand Master of the Templar Order. What could this mean? The head of the Order of the Templars saw himself as the chief of serpents. The Abraxas reveals a man deity who is empowered by his own balancing of the twin serpents. These are symbols of the mystical knowledge, and the Templars are revealing just what ancient wisdom they had uncovered. These influences must have been picked up whilst the Templars were in the Middle East and then utilized later on. We must now turn to the builder of the temple, Hiram. Hiram was the son of a Jewish mother and a Phoenician father. He was said to have been the son of a widow of the tribe of Naphtali. There are real links between Hiram and the serpent, for instance, as the standard of the tribe of Naphtali, according to Jewish tradition, is a serpent, and this could have come from Egyptian origins, as Jewish tradition states that Naphtali was the brother of Joseph, the chosen one to represent the family to Pharaoh. Hiram is said to be a son of the tribe of Dan, and even the tribe of Dan had an emblem which was amazingly the serpent. Hiram was credited with certain tools that could pierce stone. Stone is symbolic of wisdom and foundation, and Hiram's tools, therefore, could pierce the veil of wisdom. According to the Book of Kings, the temple was built of stone before it was brought to the site. It was said by tradition that neither hammer nor axe nor any tool of iron was used in the building, so how was it built? This is itself is a paradox that can only be answered by the true secret of the temple being revealed. In Exodus, Moses is told, "If you make me an altar of stone, you shall not build it of hewn stone, for if you use your tool on it, you have profaned it." It seems that the same symbolism was utilized here at the building of the temple. According to rabbinical teaching, the prefabrication of the temple was performed by the Shamir, a giant worm or serpent that could cut stones, not dissimilar to Norse and Celtic beliefs where Valhalla or Camelot were built with the fire of the dragon. The wisdom of the worm or snake Shamir was used in the construction of the temple. Architect gods such as Thoth of Egypt are linked strongly with the serpent wisdom because they are linked with the building of temples of wisdom inside ourselves. In essence, what we really have here is the temple of wisdom being built by the serpent. Strangely, the name Hiram actually means exalted head of the people and is closely related to Abraham or Abiram. Of course, this is itself is a subtle clue to the reality of Solomon's temple, as the exalted head is surely the only element which can make the real temple. It is only the head raised above all others which has the wisdom to achieve such an amazing feat. However, we also have another, more telling meaning of Hiram. A Hiram actually means exalted snake, so in either meaning, Hiram was the exalted head or snake. Both meaning being paramount to the discovery of the thread of the snake cult and its religious underlying beliefs of wisdom. Great building works were carried out across Europe, all hiding the secret symbolism of the snake and all using the architectural skills discovered whilst on their travels in the Middle East. The brazen pillars of Hiram becoming the twin pillars of the later Masons, who themselves, like Moses, the emergent serpent, emerged from the Templars. And of course, during the Crusaders periods, there was not one depiction of the crucifixion on any of the buildings he erected, backing up the claim that the Templars denied the crucifixion. It is thought that the Templars and the Cistercians found a wealth of ancient manuscripts containing secrets, giving them an insight into the truth behind Christianity. One thing that did emerge was the cult of the Baphomet head and Sophia, the elements of serpent wisdom. If they discovered the Holy Grail, as many had said, then the secrets of the Grail were what they truly discovered. So far, we have seen that the true temple must not be touched by hand, that Moses was an emergent serpent from Egypt, and that Hiram, the exalted head or snake, was the master of balance. We have also seen that inside this temple was Ashira, the entwined serpent goddess worshipped across the known world under different guises and alive and well today in the myths of Mary. We have also seen that a mystical serpent helped in the creation of the temple, and that it was a secret discovered by the Knights Templar, whose very own Grand Master had the symbol of the serpentine Abraxas. But what about the supposed real Temple of Solomon? Did it ever exist? During the period traditionally ascribed to that of King Solomon, namely 1000 to 200 BC, we are specifically talking about the Iron Age. According to Professor James Pritchard, the so-called cities of Megiddo, Giza and Hazor, and Jerusalem itself were in reality more like villages within their relatively small public buildings and poorly constructed dwellings with clay floors. The objects reveal a material culture which, even by the standards of the ancient Near East, could not be judged sophisticated or luxurious. The magnificence of the Age of Solomon is parochial and decidedly lackluster, but the First Book of Kings implies exactly the opposite. So for there to have been a temple of the magnitude that we are led to believe, then we need an archaeological miracle. We need to uncover a massive edifice with all the surrounding magnificence that is implied, and yet the archaeology reveals villages and poorly constructed dwellings. No wonder that the exact position of the temple is hotly debated. Its symbol cannot be found. Again, we find the author David Roll in his book, A Test of Time, saying, Byblos is rich in fine stone buildings from the Bronze Age. However, when it comes to the Iron Age, which is purportedly the time of Solomon and his ally Hiram, there are no stone buildings at Byblos. How then did Solomon acquire building expertise from Phoenicia? If the Phoenicians did not have the skill or resources to build stone structures for themselves. But of course, there is more evidence we can show to prove that the temple was purely a metaphor and in fact never existed in reality. The Temple of Solomon has been called Templi Omnium Hominum Pax Abbas, meaning the God of the Temple of Peace among men. Shortening down, this reverts to Tem of Ab to Baphomet. Baphomet, of course, is the head which the Knights Templar were accused of worshipping. Bapha means immersion, as in baptism, and metes mean wisdom. Baphomet, therefore, is the immersion of oneself in wisdom, the true inner reality and the true and only divinity. It is the true temple, so the Templars were simply accused of worshipping their own head, like the exalted head of Hiram, which was nothing more than the immersion in their own inner wisdom. This, of course, is a great heresy, but one that was for some reason allowed to fester and grow, like giving the Templars sufficient rope to hang themselves when the time was right. This is the great secret of the Templars, and one that indicates the truth of the temple, namely that what they discovered in that hot, humid country just after the First Crusade could very well have been found back in rainy Europe, themselves. To discover how this is so, and for a deeper insight, we need to investigate two main players who supposedly walked the grand corridors of power in the 10th century BC, Solomon and Sheba. Historically, Solomon is supposed to have been the king of Israel and David's chosen heir. He is said to be the wisest man who ever lived and authored Ecclesiastes and the Song of Solomon, as well as many Proverbs and Psalms. Solomon supposedly grew up in a polygamous household with David's 18 wives. His own mother was Bathsheba. Of course, this then is yet another repetition we have seen again and again in the Bible. Bath is simply house of, and Sheba is Saba, the kingdom of the Sabaeans, the serpent worshippers. So King David was married or in union with the house of Sheba. There are amazingly links here to the tales of King Arthur. David basically took Bathsheba from Uriah and created this savior King Solomon. In the tales of Arthur, much the same is done when Uther Pendragon takes Igraine from her husband to produce the savior King Arthur, and all is well in the land. Arthur, of course, goes on to marry the queen of serpents, Guinevere. Just as Solomon goes on to marry Sheba, the queen of the land of serpents. It is a repetitive process of teaching, and in the tales of Arthur, it is a tale that erupted upon the European scene following the Crusades into the Holy Land. But of course, there is absolutely no literal evidence for any of this other than the biblical and religious texts. There is no hard archaeological or historical evidence for Solomon's existence whatsoever. We must, in this context, therefore, take all that is said about King Solomon as if it were purely symbolic and therefore had other meanings. In this way, the story becomes clear as a teaching of wisdom. The Queen of Sheba is a version quite simply of Asherah, and when she departs from her land to visit the passionate King Solomon, she is entering the temple as the serpent queen herself. Sheba came to Solomon and they were equal. She was the serpent queen of Asherah land. She was indicative of the Asherah feminine aspect, which we have seen was inside the temple itself, and there is no wonder her story was utilized. When Sheba visited Solomon, she was the peaceful side of ourselves, meeting and balancing the powerful but often fiery side of our internal mind. together, and in balance both became strong and give us our true self, which is depicted as the Savior Son. But the process is repetitive and must constantly be recycled to remain a powerful tool. This is implied when Sheba leaves Solomon. After Sheba's departure, Solomon continues to write wise words, but Israel as a whole deteriorates, just as England loses its fertility when Arthur is split from Guinevere. The tales are the same and have the same ancient and sacred meaning, that we must work hard to maintain balance or risk losing all. The crowning glory of Solomon's wise life, though, was nothing other than the temple, and this was the purpose of our research, the pure fact that the story of Solomon and Sheba are stories of ancient wisdom and psychological teaching leaves us no other option than to see the temple itself as purely symbolic. This secret of the Temple of Solomon was passed on to the Freemasons. To most people, the temple is of great importance, but to the Masons it is transcendent. This word means quite simply to excel beyond normal human capabilities. That is, the temple hides a deeper meaning for Freemasons than for everybody else, and that meaning is even bigger than the ordinary human reasoning. We are told that in order to build this temple, we must not use might or power, but spirit. How can we build a physical structure with just spirit? We can't, but we can build a spiritual structure with spirit. I have visited many cathedrals and churches, looking always for the fragments of this living esoteric life and Gnostic influence. Normally I am accompanied by my wife and mad children, running around like a pair of frenzied berserkers on their perpetual warpath, all to the disdain of the men in frocks. On one particular occasion we visited Lincoln Cathedral, and after my wife was sedated for having to pay the extortionate entrance fee for a building the sweat and blood of our ancestors built, we slowly looked around. The children shot off as usual looking for snakes and Templar crosses. After taking several photographs and being immersed in the history of the gray stone, my wife, looking rather glum, said, "You know, it's just going to be a rockery one day." At first I put this observation down to a usual hatred for boring stone buildings, as I had been destroying her soul for years with trips to rockeries and quarries, but then I thought, maybe she's right. I looked around the various self-important Christian clergy, all pompous and self-righteous, no different to 1,000 other churches and places of worship I had visited over the years. In some places, however, there was life, and the stones did become animated like a living temple, but others were dull and had been overtaken with desires or causes of suffering we ourselves must overcome. Mankind did indeed affect the buildings he erected, whether for good or bad. In this instance, I was reminded of the time Jesus cast out the moneylenders from the temple, and the analogy stuck, charging fees that poor people simply cannot afford for a self-righteous and pompous trip around a dead religious building is something the real Christ would get very angry about. This should be a place of reflection in the true sense of the word, to reflect our inner divinity, not a place of finance. If the life is there, the money will come, as any modern evangelist will tell you. The analogy swept over me that this massive edifice to a non-existent God high on a hillside was no different to the human temple we have been discussing. It was crumbling under its own sins. There was no longer any life in the place except the kind of the life that Jesus kicked out of the temple. Yet again, my wife, my literal feminine principle, had brought something home to me. She has often astounded me with her insights that I had all too regularly been engrossed to see for myself. Yet again, this is the wisdom of the ages playing out in the physical, three-dimensional manner, man and wife in unison and unity. Once we understand the true nature of our own interconnectedness to each other and the very universe, then we will have that knowledge or gnosis of the very thing we are aiming at. We will understand fully that all faiths, all religions, all myths and traditions all relate to one thing, the truth of ourself. Once mankind has built its 6 billion temples, then maybe there will be hope for the world. Until then, let's keep turning those rockeries and quarries into our own little temples.